Good morning, everyone. My name is Donna Glover. Thank you for joining us today. Today, we're talking about cyber threats, key considerations for employers, and joining me is my colleague, Alyssa Chesler. Before we dig in, we're going to share our housekeeping notes. You'll see a Q&A box. We welcome you to submit your questions. We'll do our best to get to them during the presentation. Today, we want your feedback, so please complete the survey at the end of the webinar. We do love that feedback and look for additional ideas for topics in your feedback. You'll get a PDF of the presentation as a thank you in an email, but you also have it available in the resource list on your platform there, and you can always connect with us via social media. So by way of introductions to get started, my name is Donna Glover. I'm a shareholder in the Baltimore office. I am an employment lawyer, and I work all with employers, defending them in litigation, charges of discrimination, do a lot of advice and counsel and training. And as I mentioned, with me is Alyssa Chesler. And Alyssa, why don't you introduce yourself?
Thanks, Donna. So hello, everyone. Thanks for attending today. I am a shareholder in the Nashville and Washington, D.C. offices of Baker Donaldson. I call myself recovering in-house counsel. I spent the first half of my career as in-house counsel dealing with a variety of issues for several companies in the greater D.C. area. And since that time coming to Baker about 15 years ago, I founded our data protection, privacy, and cybersecurity team here. We have a really nice team of people. And so we work with all organizations in their roles, respective roles, including as their role as an employer. And that's how we'll be talking to you today.
Great. Thank you, Alyssa. Now, before we get to the meat of presentation, we're going to get to know you a little bit by asking you a few poll questions. And here's the first one. So has your business conducted a cyber threat assessment, for example, a review of your technologies, the processes that you might have in place to detect and prevent a cyber attack or a ransomware related incident, phishing, and those types of things? If you could take a few minutes to answer for us yes or no, and we will let you know what the results are in one moment. We have about 30% of folks responding. We'll give you another 30 seconds or a minute to chime in for us. We appreciate that.
There's no wrong answer.
Correct. It's yes or no. It's pretty binary too, right? That's funny. All right. Got about 53%. I'm going to give it just a few more seconds here to let you log your answers.
And I suspect, you know, now looking back, I wonder if some of you maybe don't even know. So,
yeah,
that's possible.
All right. It looks like we have a good number in. So I'm going to see what their results look like here and share those with you. And 81.4% of you have conducted a cyber threat assessment, which is great news. About 19% of you have not. So that's helpful to know, you know, what you've done in your businesses and what you might need to do. And hopefully we can share some of that with you today. We're going to have another question here, and we'd like you to rate your confidence. How satisfied are you in terms of regulatory compliance mandates? For example, GDPR, FINRA, HIPAA. How confident are you that you're satisfying those compliance mandates?
Right. And I'll add there, you know, you also probably have state law obligations or SEC if you're a public company, all different size organizations.
That's right. So take a few minutes to answer that. We'll give you 30 to 45 seconds or so to chime in.
Let's see. I think this might be a harder question.
Yeah, it is a harder question. I remember, you know, I didn't share in the beginning my background, but I spent about 18 years in HR. And, you know, recalling those days and the issues that you dealt with IT security and confidentiality and non-disclosure, it's a lot to think about when you're thinking about protecting your business and your protectable information. All right, we've got a good number in, so I'm going to share the results. Ooh, we have about 66% that are 75% confident 17%, 100% confidence, which is terrific. Couple struggling, and about 50% are confident. So those are pretty good scores that we're looking at there. And finally, just getting to know your business a little bit for today's session. What is your employee population size? If you could take just a minute or two to respond there, or 30 seconds or so, I should say, to respond there, we would appreciate it. Just gives us a feel for the size of the business that is with us today.
And, while we're waiting, you know, I'll note that even companies that are as small as under 50, right, five employees, you can still have the exact same epic problem that is significant for your organization, regardless of the size, when we talk about these issues.
That's right. Exactly right. All right, we've got a good number in, so let's see what our results are. And a good majority here, 50.4% or 500 and over, so large organizations, and you can see the other results as well. So we appreciate you taking the time to participate with us there. We're going to start today's session really by telling you a little bit of a story. And this is a case that happened that we dealt with here at Baker Donaldson, a client of ours that was a bank. And they had employed a risk manager, and she was a certified internal auditor. She was a certified information systems auditor. She came highly qualified and recommended. And the bank, as you might imagine, because they're a financial institution, maintained confidentiality agreements, non-disclosure agreements, restricting employee access, use and disclosure of their confidential and sensitive information. Here I'm referring to that as CSI. And the employees required, all of their employees, including the risk manager, was required to acknowledge those policies in writing. The employee ended up having performance problems short of a year of service. And she was scheduled for a meeting with her boss, which was really the president of the bank, along with the vice president of HR, to discuss a below expectations evaluation. And the intent of that meeting really was to help her, not to punish her or not an exit to the door. It really was to try to explain to her what their expectations were, make sure she was on the same page as they were. Just prior to that meeting, her boss was notified of an increase in outbound email traffic from her work email account to her personal email account. So there was a big increase. They had a system set up where if there was an increase in outbound traffic, the IT person was notified. He then notified her boss that this was occurring. And they got this notification just prior to meeting with her for the performance improvement plan, you know, to talk to her about that plan. And so what they did during that meeting was raise that with her and ask her why this outbound traffic had increased. And she didn't say much. She sort of, you know, demurred and said, well, you know, I'm kind of worried about my job. And they said, well, what we're going to do is suspend you until we investigate what's going on here. So they didn't expect to be doing that because it was just a PIP that they were going to talk to her about. So they did the investigation, and they learned that she had taken protected information, sensitive account information, loan applications, credit histories of certain customers of the bank. And so they fired her for violating those policies. And obviously her actions created liability for them. So we partnered with one of Alyssa's colleagues, did the required notifications to the customers that were affected, offered them the ability to sign up for free tracking, you know, of their accounts and identity theft and all of that. So it put a lot of burden on the bank. And then the sort of the end of the story is, well, what did we do about that? So after we fixed the problem with our customers, we get a demand letter from her attorney alleging discrimination. She later files a charge. She wanted $250,000 to settle her claims against the company. And we said, no, thank you. And we actually sued her under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, which Alyssa is going to talk about today. In the end, we settled that case in our favor. And one of the reasons was the tool that we had under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. And we wanted to share this with you today because the Van Buren case that Alyssa is talking about in a couple of minutes has changed that for employers. It's not as easy to raise claims now under that act. And that's one of the topics we'll talk about today. So as the lead-in to our session today, keep this case in mind as you listen to Alyssa. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Alyssa.
Thank you. All right. So just to give you a quick high level, so these are some of the things that we're going to cover as we get to this, right? We're going to go over some data protection considerations, talk about insider threats, which as human resources professionals, you really need to be focused on. Van Buren, as we just discussed. And then always a hot topic, so I can never have a conversation with anyone where I don't get to talk about ransomware because each time I talk about it, I say something different because it's totally changing. Some recent DOL guidance. And then if there's some time, a little HIPAA for plan sponsors. So as we move on to the next slide, starting with data protection considerations, and we can go to the next one. What data are you protecting? And again, you know, I think there's all different kinds of data. And as human resources professionals, you need to also be thinking of the areas that your employees could be going into as an insider, right? There are financial losses that come as a part of this with a business email compromise or a wire fraud, right? We have privacy issues. Certainly, if you work for somebody as big as Coca-Cola, there's IP theft. But we've had some very small, privately owned companies with IP theft. And even in a very rural area in the Southeast, small private company, but they had the Chinese in their systems for IP theft. And the way they found out, they really had no intrusion detection, anything on their software, was because the FBI called them and said, hey, by the way, the Chinese have taken everything. That happened about 6 months ago, but you know, you might want to close things up. So IP theft is a real thing that you probably, again, hear about in the news, but again, maybe not HR's responsibility, but as you're talking to your other management key professionals, you should be reminding them of these issues. Of course, unauthorized disclosure. And then, of course, insiders can create all sorts of disruption of IT services, damage to the infrastructure. Sometimes if there's a hospital involved, right, there's actual personal injury issues and concerns, as well as the ultimate loss of life. And by the way, on the personal injury, again, I'm sure you're all watching with going back to IP, I mean, how some of these new autonomous vehicles are working. So it's a very evolving space. You have to think about it in the realm of what your organization is doing. So how can we help you? Next slide. The first thing I want to mention is this awesome resource that y'all can find from the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency. CISA has a very thick threat mitigation guide. It is on their website, and it is actually fantastic. We're going to go through several slides about this. And again, as a human resources professional, you're that first line of defense with discussing these issues, anticipating these issues, and really making sure that you've thought through where we are today with respect to, again, anticipating and issuing those right policies and procedures, partnering with management in not just the IT department, but also operations, because what we're also seeing now, right, if you think about IT contracts, they're not always in the IT space. For example, as human resources professionals, you may be responsible for your agreement with an ADP-like platform or a payroll platform or any other HR platform. Well, when you're reading those terms and conditions, sure, you're thinking about it from a business standpoint. Hopefully, you're working with your IT professionals from a, wow, they're hosting a lot of our personal information standpoint. How do we need to think about that? Who's going to have access, right? And how do we think about that whole life cycle too, because if we switch from vendor one to vendor two, is that information going to stay with vendor one? Is it going to move to vendor two? But again, I want to go back to focusing on threat mitigation as it relates to your insiders. Next slide, please. So as CISA has really thought about this too, right? This is a different riff on some of what we're talking about. There's all sorts of craziness going on. And you guys probably, again, several years ago, and Don and I, in anticipation of this presentation, started to think and talk about where this came from. And it is very interesting that this insider threat mitigation guide also includes workplace violence issues, right? Active shooting issues. Because what you have, if you think about it, right, if you have an active shooter, you have violence coming, you have somebody who has an extreme issue. Well, the same can be true for a cyber event, especially somebody who is doing it from an intentional standpoint, right? It's watching your own employees to know, are they going to hit a button and delete the keys to the castle? Are they going to encrypt your data without your knowledge? What could they do? Are they leaving behind presents, as it were, on their way out the door, right? So we think about those threats. We're thinking about cyber threats. Sometimes they're intentional. Sometimes they're unintentional. And then, of course, there's espionage. We have those employees who are stealing information, maybe for their own economic benefit. Maybe in Donna's scenario, maybe they're going to go to the next bank and set themselves up and call their old customers, right? That might be what's in the mind of somebody who's trying to send themselves personal information from first employer to who they perceive might be the next employer. That is not permissible and is a problem, right?
And Lisa, I think things have changed a lot today, but I'll just throw one more thing in that I've heard in the past from employers. They don't think about password and access. And when the IT person goes, or the person who knew how to run that one system goes, and it was a bad separation, a bad divorce, and nobody knows the passwords, that's, another security type of issue to get your hands around. That has changed a lot, I think, but I have seen that in the past as well in terms of an insider threat, because that person keeps the keys to everything.
That's right.
To the vest.
That's right. So we just got in a really good question, and I'll read it to y'all, which is, in our company, the IT director and manager, along with the assistance of the COO, take the lead on cybersecurity in our company. Should our HR department be taking the lead? I don't think you should be taking the lead, but you are as valued a member of that important team as the CIO, CSO, COO, CEO. This is very much a team effort, and too much has been relied on IT personnel as being the cyber people. And there is so much that is outside of their hands, especially as it relates to insiders, and they would benefit greatly from that partnership. So as we advise our clients on, is it the lead? No, but I do think it is a team effort, and at different situations, HR professionals will be in a leading role and having a really important part to that. And I will say, use that elbow grease, muscle in there, because at the end of the day, if you don't know some of the plans and programs about what and how things are being done, you will be paying catch up in a very stressful situation.
I think it's also harder for HR people then to be thinking about, well, what policies do we need in place to protect the organization and protect our interests, with respect to employees, right? So the team, I think, as you said, Alyssa, is incredibly important that HR is part of that team.
And HR personnel, in my past experience, have also been the ones who are also thinking about the larger issues. In your prior example, we had a bank, and they had sophisticated systems and processes in place to see, is data leaving, okay? We don't see that in some, especially smaller entities. you know, we can talk about when and if that is what we would consider to be best practice, why it should be implemented, how it should be implemented. But going to that next step, which is thinking about the privacy of your employees and how that really does end up being largely an HR consideration and making sure that employees know how and if they're being monitored. As we got to probably exactly this time last year where we had been several months into COVID and there were concerns about whether or not people were working enough at home, were they actually getting things done? We had an influx of privacy questions about monitoring. You know, you could see where people were being monitored and whether or not that was going to fit into the larger HR picture is a question, a real question. All right, but let's move on. So, and to the point too of all the different things you need to consider as you are putting together what I will call an insider threat mindset and figuring out how that will go into your larger data protection program. You know, this is not all of them. These are some of the many considerations. And again, this is from that CISA guide that I'll stop holding up but because you've seen it, but this is straight from that CISA guide. All these different regulations and things that you need to be thinking about as you draw it together. This is not simple stuff. And so, you know, grabbing something from the internet and feeling comfortable that it really has all those considerations that you need can be a dangerous thing. I'll also want to point to a couple of them that I, in my experience, have found to be incredibly helpful. Was one of those is a pre-hire background check. Many of you are probably doing these. But I will tell you, we're starting to get to a point where it may not be a one-size-fits-all. And as Donna and I were talking, as we go forward into the Van Buren case, one of the interesting people or groups of people that you maybe need to think a little bit more about are your IT people. Because they also have this technological ability to create potentially more havoc and more issues. And so if you have somebody, and we're also desperate for experienced personnel that, I mean, it's are they breathing and do they know how to get into a computer? I mean, they might just get hired. Really being thoughtful and thinking about what they're going to potentially evolve to, too. Because, again, you can think of them, well, they're going to have a lower level position, maybe not huge access, maybe not administrator rights. But as people go on and next thing you know, they're leading the help desk and they have all sorts of administrative rights on your network and systems. That's something that you should all be thinking about. So thinking really about that end game, not always about what they're being hired for, is something that I would certainly encourage. excuse me. And then, of course, you have all the different points where you might have considerations when you're developing this program, like those laws that you may have as a manufacturer more OSHA laws than, say, Freedom of Information Act laws. All of them need to be considered moving forward. And, you know, what I really liked about this slide and thinking about that internal malicious threat, which, again, people are going to sometimes say, well, did you have any idea human resources? And, of course, you're only as good as what supervisors are cluing you into. But, you know, it's an evolution very much like that active shooter, right? There's a grievance, a perceived or real problem, right? They're starting to develop plans and think about it. And as they're exploring, this is starting to get three and four is where you maybe can start to have some technological tools that may be helpful in alerting you. Again, like that earlier example, what kind of alerts might you get? And this is, again, where you can partner with talking to your IT people in the next few days to say, well, what are we doing? And at what point would you be bringing me into the conversation? Right? Knowing when you're going to get brought into the conversation, I think for some of you may be very eye-opening. One, because they'll look at you with a blank stare and say, oh, I don't know, right? Or two, you think, well, gee, that's too late. We've already hit DEFCON 9 and we're scrambling. So just thinking about that. And again, another tool to open up that dialogue, this might be the great thing to point to your IT or management to say, well, where are we in this chain in terms of technology and where human resources has a role? Moving on. This is direct from that, a little bit of changes. You know this already, so I'm not going to spend too much time on this. People as sensors, right? So getting those clues that, something seems to be off with Jimmy today, you know, frame of reference. And again, amping it up when you know, well, what kind of access, not just about what concerns do we have, but what kind of, and again, could this person be an active shooter? It's could this person or would this person feel like they have the technological ability and or right to cause a threat to your system? The monitoring we discussed, so let's go to the next slide. All right, and then of course, look, if we're not gonna be doing background checks on everybody or whatever, you want to think about all those different indicators and tools in your toolbox. I will focus as you get down to the bottom, right, with some of those organizational and environmental indicators, right? Having the right culture is important to human resources for innumerable issues, for sure. This is clearly becoming one of them, if not the number one. Because articulating expectations about what your culture is for the protection of data, for the protection of the system, is going to be hugely important. Now, I'm going to pause here and just let you know, on the next slide, I'm going to be presenting, it's about a minute video that is also on the CISA website. It is just a trailer for a training. And the reason I wanted to show this to you is to, again, let you know what a great resource you have out there on the CISA website. They have longer trainings that you can take yourself and or share with your management. Donna.
In today's threat environment, the idea of separating the insider threat or the cyber threat from the insurgency threat is impossible to do.
This person is deceiving everybody, to include you.
And what do we always hear afterward? We hear that there was an indicator. Somebody made an outcry, provided information to HR or to a supervisor, but that information was never acted upon.
It was a matter of not bringing them all together. We all know that. We talk about connecting the dots. But we haven't yet had a real conversation about what that means.
They're paying somebody off to insert a thumb drive, somebody who actually works there or has normal access. They're not hacking anything. They're manipulating people, and they're able to get inside. So once they get on the network, they're already inside. They're already a trusted user, so firewall's not going to do anything. We're already past the firewall.
That's a warning. We would much rather check that out and have it lead to nothing than not get the call and have an incident occur.
I've always said that the easiest person to fool is usually yourself.
So I loved this. I mean, it's very dramatic, but, you know, we're all reading and hearing a lot about what's happening in the cyber world. And I think we're all predisposed to thinking it's that outside huge threat, right, from beyond our borders. But you all need to understand we are seeing innumerable issues with employees, and now former employees in many cases, that cannot be underestimated. And getting that point across also to management is hugely important. So my steps, recommendations, right? Number one is know the risks. What data are we protecting? So you all are likely responsible for making sure that wherever you're holding sensitive employee data has certain controls in place. Hopefully the access is limited to HR professionals and limited IT professionals. And frankly, you need to know which IT professionals have access And is it too many to the personnel information that you all have? Then, of course, going to and really having a conversation and making sure you're comfortable that you know all the different areas to protect within your organization, whether it be IP or systems, et cetera, that are processing. Second recommendation, it's time to review your employee handbook. You really do, and through talking about a couple of other things later on in this presentation, you're really going to want to think about what should be added at this point to your employee handbook versus other places of policies and procedures that, again, you should be training on. Okay. And then the good news is, I've already said, partner with management. So we're going to move on to the case that we somewhat advertised we'd be talking about today, which is the Van Buren case. So Van Buren case is pretty exciting, right? We're all excited, cyber geeks, that we have a new case that went before the Supreme Court. But then it became, oh, we're not so excited, because admittedly, I have to say, may or may not, I'm not going to argue about whether or not the answer was the right answer from a legal point of view, but it's a little disappointing if the tools in our toolbox that we have been using to date may have just been diminished. So this is hugely important for you all, because as Donna mentioned in that case and the example that she used at the beginning, we cited the CFAA, right? And the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act was a great tool in our tool shed. It has now been diminished. So let's just talk about the facts for a moment, right? The facts were that a police sergeant ran a license plate search on a system in exchange for money. Okay. So it was, you know, an improper use, as we call it, right? And there was an articulated policy in the police department saying that you can't use this database that are for non-law enforcement purposes. Indeed, Mr. Van Buren had also been trained on this policy. Okay. As a police sergeant, he had valid credentials to look in that system. He had legitimate reasons to be in that system. And so began an FBI investigation, and felony charges by the government were brought against him for a violation of the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. Next slide. So, well, maybe there was two of that side, because we got to advance more.
Apologies.
Nope, that's okay.
There we go. Might not have advanced. There you go.
So let's just tell you what the law is, right? So the law originally was only for government and financial institutions, but it did expand in 1996 to protected computers, hence why we were able to use it, for example, with a bank, right? It was intended to protect certain things like passwords and these protected computers, right? There were both civil and criminal penalties. And let's focus on this, right? The unauthorized access or access that exceeds authorized access. So that quote is kind of what the Supreme Court focused on. Okay. And so the concern being that were there damages to protected computers and trafficking in data and any threats to this. So here's what happened, right? Next slide. The Supreme Court said, are we missing a slide here? There we go. That the statutory definition, right? Access a computer with authorization and to use such access to obtain information in the computer that the accessor is not entitled to so obtain. Well, here was the problem. He was entitled to obtain that information. Now, that's going to make this very difficult in the future when you have employees who rightfully have access and using it for other purposes. Now, I'll pause and say that if you're a highly regulated entity, so if you're a healthcare entity, you likely have HIPAA. If you are a financial institution, you have FDIC or FINRA or a number of other regulatory schemes, Gamm-Leach-Bliley, et cetera. right? And if you don't have any of those, you may still have state law issues. But again, what we liked about this law was the threat, frankly, of civil and criminal penalties that went through this. So,
I'm going to just take us back 1 second to that case we talked about in the beginning. Why that worked for us is because she had access. She had authorized access, cabined by those policies, right? And so the words of the policies helped us to show that she exceeded that authorized access when she stole the materials to bolster her discrimination claim. And really, that's what her attorney said was her defense. Oh, she just took this because she was planning on filing claims against the bank. But the reason we had leverage was because of that exceeds authorized access phrase in the statute.
Right. So what's gonna come of this? We anticipate hopefully some congressional action on a national scale, but being Congress as it is, we are not waiting for that. And so, you know, we want to think through what do we tell you or what is our best advice today? So next slide. Our best advice today, number one, is to think about additional password protections for sensitive information, where things are going, how they're stored, kind of what we call break the glass-like situations, right? Adding potentially, and again, there's going to be a push-pull on an operations basis of some of this. But more importantly, access restrictions. There's a concept within technology called role-based access controls. So it's, again, really thinking about, do employees need access to every area? As you create share files and sectioning off areas, really revisiting those and revisiting those at intervals. Again, so one, taking now to refresh and thinking about, are you employing the right access controls? But secondarily, upon a, not just upon a hire, but also as somebody gets a promotion or a demotion or anticipation of a potential termination. Thinking about all those access controls at intervals as well as specific times, right? So thinking about clarifying areas also and reminding people that, and again, your average employee isn't going to be thinking about Van Buren and, oh, all of a sudden I have this great ability to do bad things. They're either bad people or they aren't, hopefully. But we want to start thinking through what are the right ways for you all to be policing these issues, thinking through these issues, and protecting your data.
And Alyssa, I'll just add that I think that that is the one, what you just described is one of the key ways to, I don't want to say get around Van Buren's holding, but it kind of is true. If you craft computer use policies, you know, that expressly forbids and prevents employees from accessing particular files or folders or databases, you might still can bring a claim under the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, right? Even under this holding, but you're going to have those systems set up properly, your policies set up properly, and your access rights really controlled in order to use that tool.
Absolutely. Thank you. Good point. All right. But now let's get to the fun stuff. I don't know if you think this is fun as I do, but, you know, what keeps me up at night is our next slide, right? And so what am I really worried about? I am worried about the insider threat. But you, like everyone else, you're probably hearing about the next slide, you know, the ransomware that's happening out there. And how that's really coming about. Now, first and foremost, most, not all, but most ransomware are coming in through your very good and well-intentioned employees who maybe have taken phishing tests and training innumerable times, but for whatever reason are still falling victim to the ransomware threats. But who are we against here? There are over 40 advanced persistent threats out there, and those are organized crime. Those are nation state actors, whether it's Russia, China, North Korea, they're all in the game. And they're very specific and very organized. Okay. We're not dealing with, you know, again, and we are sometimes dealing with, but for the most part, the, you know, teenager sitting in his mom's basement playing video games and in between doing some ransomware, not so as much of the model as it used to be. And why are they doing it? Because it's incredibly lucrative. Again, you can read in the press all about the, you know, the astronomical amounts of money that are being paid. But there's evolving rules in this. And what I mean by that is the government is now very strict and really does not want you paying. So in the old days, as we did threat exercises with our clients, one of the first questions, I would sit them down and I would say, okay, are you paying the ransomware or not? And then no matter what they said, I always tripped them up because it was like, yes, we are. I said, okay. Can you do that under your insurance? Do you have enough money? How are you going to pay the Bitcoin? Do you have a Bitcoin folder, right? We would go through all this other stuff. And they say, oh, no. And then I'd say, and the government really doesn't want you to do it. Okay, then we're not going to do it. I said, okay, now you don't have access to your systems. How are you going to conduct business? How are you going to set back up? Are you going to be able to communicate? You're all encrypted. You're locked up. What are you going to do, right? We still do that a little bit, but now also you really do have the government potentially stopping you at times from being able to pay that ransom. So going back to that second scenario is, are you going to be able to operate? And sure, you're hearing about those large entities that have enough money or enough insurance and enough coverage to recover, regardless a little bit of whether or not their backup plan was good enough or not. That's not always the case. And there are entities that are not able to recover from a real ransomware threat. And that, I think, is a very important message to make sure that your people know. There is a report, there's many reports that come up about cyber incidents. The 2021 Verizon report took a look at about 80,000 incidents. Over 5,200 of them were what we will call actual breaches, right? So the incident is where they try, a breach is where they succeed, okay? And there is something in the middle, again, about how their legal definitions go, but trust me, the 80,000 incidents is, we're talking about serious ones. There are many, many more than that. So don't think it can't happen to you. Now, 85% of those had a human threat. This is what it looks like. Here's what happens, right? This is going to jump up. It's a little older looking thing, but have you trained your employees to know when this comes up, when this threat comes up, do your people even know who to call or how to call? And do you all have, by the way, another helpful hint, make sure that you have a documented incident response plan, that it has people's phone numbers in it, and that it's in paper. And you should be one of the few that also has it in paper, because in a real threat, you many times cannot communicate at all because your email is gone. You're going to need a way to communicate with each other. And so the first thing is to make sure you have that in paper. So next slide. And this is my little Keystone Cops. While a significant number of you mentioned that you have done incident response testing, size does not fit all, because in how you will respond to a ransomware threat is very different than how you will respond to a business email compromise, is very different than how you will respond to an insider stealing IP. And you need to practice all of those scenarios, not just one. Okay. And you also must practice it, I think, in a real world scenario, which is to include your legal counsel, so that you've thought through attorney-client privilege issues, you've thought through who you may be using from the outside, how that goes. And again, human resources is front and center, because one of the main things, assuming that it is not an internal issue, i.e. an insider threat, we'll put those issues aside that you'll have to deal with. the communication to staff is hugely important, and you're going to be very incremental and instrumental in making sure the messaging is right, that it is going out right, and that people are communicating. Please avoid the Keystone Cop scenario. All right, next thing. Department of Labor guidance. This came out in April, and I think it's really important. So we're segueing away. This is for those of you HR professionals who are also responsible for benefits. There is a real drive in every part of government to think about the protection of issues, and we are seeing lots of financial institutions, hedge funds, etc., falling prey to incidents. And you need to make sure those vendors that you are utilizing are, one, meeting your expectation for the protection of you and your employees' information, and making sure that there are good controls in place so that that money does not fall victim to a compromise, and that your people's information does not fall victim. So let me just be very clear. While this Department of Labor advice was kind of focused and thoughtful as it relates to being plan sponsors of pension plans and 401ks and that world, it applies throughout the scenario. It should apply to many things. So as you go to this guidance and as you think about it, I would certainly encourage you to look through these best practices, think about how you're going to choose a vendor. And don't think that just because a vendor is a big one, that they're doing a good job. They're not all the same. And it is, I think, important to have that as a part of your consideration, whether it's by RFP or not, of, is this vendor doing what we think they should be doing? I will also note that since that, we have created for a lot of our clients a addendum to go with their engagements. So if you think about it in kind of the HIPAA context, for those of you that do benefits issues for a self-insured plan and you have to have a business associate agreement with your TPA, it's the same concept that is in a business associate agreement, that they will only use the data and that they will certainly safeguard the data. And then we go through a little more specifically what controls we think they need to have in place. Now, maybe they come back and negotiate and they don't like a particular clause. That should not be the end of it. That opens up a dialogue. And sometimes I will even argue that that's almost better than anything else, because it means that they've actually read it rather than just signing it. And you at least go in with open eyes. What are their potential concerns? So again, this Department of Labor advice, which I would encourage you to go see, should be applied broadly beyond just those 401k and pension plans. And last but not least, so we're doing pretty well on time, so if y'all have questions, start storing them up. HIPAA compliance. Okay, I realize some of you are clearly outside of healthcare. HIPAA compliance, I think, is widely not understood. It came up a lot in the COVID context because, as some of you asked, for vaccine information, no, that's a HIPAA violation, which it isn't, to ask for vaccine information. However, it's a good opportunity as you're thinking through these things to think about what you do have when and if you do have HIPAA compliance obligations. So next slide. So let me just walk you through this, right? Employers do not have to comply with HIPAA. However, plans, group health plans or other plans that are covered by HIPAA, especially when they are self-insured or have parts of their benefit programs, which then mean that you have to have a HIPAA compliance program, you and your role as a plan sponsor must make sure that you have what you need in place. Smaller organizations, I think, tend to struggle with this, but larger ones do as well. Okay, so a couple points. Make sure that your plan documents have the required HIPAA statements in them. And are they being articulated correctly? Second, as you are executing business associate agreements with those TPAs or third-party providers, brokers, whomever, to protect your information, don't just sign them, okay? They now contain other clauses that are not required by HIPAA. You may be giving up a lot. You may be giving up indemnification. There may be a limitation of liability in there that may not be a part of this. So let's be very clear that, you know, these business associate agreements are worth actually reading. And when they go outside of HIPAA, they go outside of HIPAA. There are private. Sorry, go ahead.
Melissa, sorry to interrupt. We have a question that just came in about vaccines. Do you want to repeat what you said? The question is, vaccines are not covered under HIPAA? Do you want to?
Yes. Yeah. So when
that again?
Sure. So when you get your employee information, right, having nothing to do with your group health plan, if you're asking for health information, whether it be in the FMLA world or in this new vaccine COVID world, that's not HIPAA, okay? If you were trying to, for example, run a report, if you have Blue Cross as your TPA and you tried to ask Blue Cross, you know, please send us a list of everybody who submitted a vaccine claim, that's HIPAA. But there is a distinction, okay? And so go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I'll just add to that. If you have not looked at the EEOC's technical guidance on the vaccines, you can find that obviously on the EEOC's website. They make clear that an employer has the right to ask whether an employee is vaccinated or not. It does not implicate the ADA. But if you ask the information, and I know you all know the answer to this, right? Under the Americans with Disabilities Act and similar state laws, you have confidentiality obligations. So if you're collecting the information, just like you would in the context of, let's say, a request for a workplace accommodation that you need medical information for to assess and figure out what you can do reasonably to accommodate that person, that is obviously protected under the Americans with Disabilities Act from a confidentiality standpoint, so we can't go blathering about it. And only those who have a need to know get to know, right? So you do have to be careful with the information you're collecting, but the idea that you're collecting it doesn't violate employment laws, nor is it HIPAA covered. And I think Alyssa's example was really a good one, right? If it's a claim, a healthcare claim for a vaccination being covered, that's different from I'm an employer asking if my employee is vaccinated or not and collecting that information.
Right.
I think Timothy asked a similar question. Doesn't drug testing and the results of those types of tests fall under HIPAA as well as pre-employment physicals? And the answer is no. One thing I try to encourage employers to think about, because you're generally not a HIPAA-covered entity, the HIPAA relationship is between the provider and the employee. That is why, for example, the ADA makes clear in their regulations that it's not a HIPAA issue when you ask for that medical documentation. Same with FMLA regulations. So it's not a HIPAA relationship there between you and that employee.
Yes, although I will say one quick point to that, and it can trick up healthcare providers. They always kind of get this very confused. So you're in your role as a provider and your role as an employer, and you need to keep those lines very clear. There needs to be firewalls. So if, for example, and I don't know the organization in question here, but if you are a healthcare provider and as a healthcare provider, maybe you're doing that drug testing or maybe you're doing that physical, okay, you can't just shoot the information over to HR. It needs to go for the process as if it was completely different entities across town and they never met. So make sure that you know what role you're in. And if you are indeed a healthcare company, just know that distinction.
That's a great point.
Yep. And then security considerations. This is yet another great way to partner with the CISO, Chief Information Security Officer. Not all organizations are large enough to have that role or that title, if you will. you know, whether it's the data protection officer or whatever, these are roles that are all new hiring things. They are roles that are going to be in a decade from now as common as, you know, the VP of HR or the director of HR. You are going to have probably the buck stops here with information security professionals. So partner with that person and let them know if you do need to have at least somewhat of a HIPAA program that you actually have it articulated. Because again, while you may not be a hospital with all sorts of, you know, EHRs and a lot of voluminous medical information, you still are required on behalf of that group health plan to maintain a program. And if you were to have an issue, we would want to be able to pull that out and show to the regulators that you actually did think through these issues in the protection of that information. And with that, we actually have a few minutes to spare. So we've had some good questions. We'd love some more if you have any.
Melissa, I have a question.
Yeah. Sure.
So I have a client that works with contractors a lot for small pieces of business where they have an uptick. They bring on a contractor under an independent contractor agreement. And in many cases, giving access to their system to the contractor. I'm imagining that's not unlike an employee, but is that different? What are your thoughts there if you're bringing on contractors and giving them access to your system?
Right. Very tricky because, again, you also want to keep that independent contractor relationship for employment issues. But there are certain things that we need to think about. Again, how much access are they going to have to what? Is it a test environment? Is it a production environment? Because a lot of times I might recommend that instead of them maintaining their Gmail address, that you give them, if it were at Baker Donaldson, a Baker Donaldson email address so that all that email retains with you. Maybe you also give them a laptop. But as you start to do this, you and I are going to have a little bit of a debate. Is that going to hurt the employment status, right? So is the contractor expected for a year or are they expected at 3 months? And if they're expected for a year, is it for three different projects? So maybe we add three different contracts. So it becomes a fact-specific analysis, but absolutely and in fact, you know, recently we have put together for a contractor in talking with the client the way that we thought it was best to try to put some protections in place. One, so that they don't lose IP or personal information. And then two, you know, outlining from the beginning, like we have some expectations and frankly, we're probably going to be watching you a bit and, you know, just know that this is important to us. And that's an important role, too, by the way, for HR. One other point to that I would add is as much as possible for these kinds of phishing training, et cetera, I might encourage HR to get employee training to some of these independent contractors.
And we have one more question. Could you please repeat how a healthcare provider as an employer should treat vaccination information? They may require, correct?
Yeah.
I'll take that first part. You can mandate the vaccination, but you have to establish opt-outs for disabilities or religious objections. And I'll point you to the EEOC technical guidance because they kind of run through that analysis for you. But yes, you can, any employer can mandate, provided you have the legal opt-outs that you need for those who cannot get vaccinated because of disabilities or religious objections.
Right. And then once it gets brought into human resources, so if I, Elisa, bring my vaccine information to my employer hospital, when I bring that in, it is not subject to HIPAA. Okay. It is me as an individual. I'm not a covered entity. Giving it to you as an employer, not a covered entity, no HIPAA. Okay. But again, you want to make sure that you're not pulling that. information from your own electronic records to try to say, I wonder if Elisa got vaccinated. I'm going to have somebody go into the report and see whether or not it's in the record. So I would certainly make sure, and it is a very important in HR departments of providers to have very clear articulated policies, what's covered by HIPAA, what is not, and making that clear to your employees. We have another question, how to suggest you convince your company to jump on board with the phishing testing. Well, gosh, that's a cultural issue. Certainly, again, you know, it's hard because, you know, they'll say if you use Colonial Pipeline, which is the latest hot ransomware, and how these things are getting in, it's just one person bringing down, you know, a whole coast of being able to get gasoline. So you can imagine in your organization, no matter what size, it can really impact you, and it can impact you hugely, and you can get hit with encryption. You know, so hard to know in your culture based on your size. You know, you're certainly welcome to email me later, and we can brainstorm for a minute or two about the best way. We generally try to give them real world examples, whether it's from us as lawyers, the newspaper, or if there is any cyber liability coverage, your insurers are very encouraging of doing this to reduce these problems.
And with that, I see we are out of time, Elisa. I just wanted to thank everybody for joining us today and for their great questions. And as Elisa said, if you do have any questions, feel free to email us. We'll be happy to answer them. And we thank you again for your participation. Take care, everyone.